Well, happy Valentine's Day. Yes, today is February 14th, 2015. You're here for North Star Oasis. Welcome aboard. My name is Jeff Williams, the host of today's show, once again. And not to be confused, I am not related to Brian Williams of NBC. However, if Brian Williams does claim that he's a cousin of mine or we're somehow related, just take that as an unemployed, suspended journalist trying to get back into the business. So again, welcome to North Star Oasis. We're really happy to have you. We're broadcasting live from the studios of Suburban Community Channels in White Bear Lake, Minnesota. And we're also rebroadcast on various other networks throughout the Twin Cities area. And you can also now find us on Facebook, North Star Oasis. Please like us on Facebook. We want to hear from you. Keep us as part of the discussion. Tell us what you like. Tell us what you don't like. And no, I do not want to be replaced by Brian Williams. I'll let you know that already up front. We are on Twitter, twitter.com/NorthStarOasis. And then you can also find us on our YouTube channel, youtube.com/NorthStarOasis. So I think by now you've got the gist of the show. We are North Star Oasis, and we're here for you. When we had last week's show, we discussed the history of Groundhog Day. Why is it significant? Why do we look at a meteorological inclined rodent to determine what's going to happen with the weather? We had a whole show on that last week. But there's actually been something, some new development that has occurred since then, and that is that the Merrimack, New Hampshire Police Department, they have actually issued an arrest warrant for Punxsutawney Phil. According to the police department, they said, "We know we are a day early. However, we here at Merrimack Police felt compelled to let the public know that there is a warrant for Punxsutawney Phil. We have received several complaints from the public that this little varmint is held up in a hole, warm and toasty. He told several people that winter should last 6 more weeks. However, he failed to disclose that it would consist of mountains of snow. If you see him, do not approach him as he is armed and dangerous. Call Merrimack Police and we will certainly take him into custody." And right now in the New England area, Boston through New Hampshire, they're buried under snow. And it may feel like Christmas out. And since there are 313 days shopping days left until Christmas, which I forgot to mention at the beginning of the show, that it's feeling like that in New England, but they're really wanting to see spring. And so they have actually put an arrest warrant for Punxsutawney Phil. Now, the question is, where is the location of this little rodent? Probably not in Pennsylvania anymore. He may be heading south of the border, maybe into Texas. He might be heading to Mexico. You know, they figure that the illegal immigration is heading from south to north, so I think Phil might be thinking that his escape route and his getaway might be best going from north to south. However, the Merrimack Police Department, on their Twitter feed, they had put the photo of the gopher from Caddyshack. Well, a gopher and a woodchuck slash groundhog are not the same. So who knows? Punxsutawney Phil might be on a street near you, as we are here in the land of the golden gophers. So welcome aboard, Phil. This is now a sanctuary city for groundhogs, and we're welcome to have you. In the meantime, we have another new development based upon a story that we had run a few weeks ago about Anonymous. The group of hacktivists have decided to turn their attention onto the ISIS, or ISIL, as President Obama would say, on the terrorists overseas, the people who are known for beheading Jordanian pilots, beheading people and then burning Jordanian pilots. And so what we're going to show you is that, and my producer's typing something here, and he says that Betty McCollum says ISIS is a young girl's name. Where he got that from, I don't know, but I will assume that Betty McCollum probably indeed did say that. I do know she made that trip over to Syria about 10 years ago and was more inclined to worry about the refugees from Iraq going into Syria than she was concerned about our own service members over there. So therefore, you know, to hear something like this out of Congresswoman McCollum would not surprise me, but I do not, disclaimer, I do not have a verifiable fact that she said that. But anyhow, Anonymous, getting back to them, this is a group that you don't know if you're going to love them or if you're going to hate them because of the stuff that they've been able to pull off here, you know, a lot of hacking into a lot of, you know, big systems. I did watch a YouTube video, it was an interview with one of the guys who was with Anonymous, and he's saying, well, the biggest reason I did all of this was because I wanted to show that there's security breaches and that we're not as secure technologically as perhaps we should be. So therefore, I got involved with Anonymous and I did all this hacking just to show that there's security vulnerabilities. And now it might be true, but there's probably a lot more going on than meets the eye. But when ISIS came out, or not ISIS, when Anonymous came out and said that they're going after ISIS on a technological front and all other terrorists after the Charlie Hebdo situation in France a few weeks back, we kind of want to cheer them on. So now, what exactly is a progress report? Well, Anonymous this week had issued the following.
Greetings, citizens of the world. We are Anonymous. Operation ISIS continues. First, we need to clarify a few things. We are Muslims, Christians, Jews. We are hackers, crackers, hacktivists, fishers, agents, spies, or just the guy from next door. We are students, administrators, workers, clerks, unemployed, rich, poor. We are young or old, gay or straight. We wear smart clothes or rugs. We are hedonists, ascetics, joyriders or activists. We come from all races, countries, religions, and ethnicity. United as one, divided by zero. We are Anonymous. Remember, the terrorists that are calling themselves Islamic State, ISIS, are not Muslims. ISIS, we will hunt you, take down your sites, accounts, emails, and expose you. From now on, no safe place for you online. You will be treated like a virus. And we are the cure. We own the internet. Now, some of ISIS Twitter accounts that were taken offline by Anonymous Red Cult Team. You will find the link in the video description. Also, you will find some Facebook accounts suspected to have been keeping contact with the terrorists, ISIS, in Syria and Iraq. Won't hurt to keep an eye on them. ISIS, we are Anonymous. We are Legion. We do not forgive. We do not forget. Expect us.
So there you have it. That's the progress report from Okay, I have to actually say something to my producer. Could you do me a favor? Take the word ISIS off of the teleprompter because I keep wanting to say it. So, anyhow, Anonymous just gave us the progress report, and I'm sure that they've got more that they're going to be saying to us in the very near future. Our freshman congressional representative, Tom Emmer, he was in the news recently for a speech that he gave on the floor of the United States House of Representatives to discuss Obamacare, also known as the Affordable Care Act. Let's go to the
Speaker, I'm pleased to yield 1 minute to one of the new members of the House of Representatives, the gentleman from Minnesota, Mr. Emmer.
Thank you, Representative Brady, and thank you for your leadership on this issue. Mr. Speaker, I rise today to address the urgent health needs of this nation. I ask my constituents to share with me how Obamacare has affected them, and I want to share a few of their stories with you today. Troy from Norwood Young America wrote that his family's premium went up and coverage went down, drastically affecting the cost of his son's hearing aid. Brian from Albertville said his wife's mental health clinic has steadily lost clients due to regulations. Today, Congress will vote to get rid of this fundamentally flawed and unworkable law. But this cannot be for show. It is not enough for Congress to simply be against Obamacare. We need to offer alternatives. By offering market-based, consumer-focused reforms, we can find real solutions, and I'm committed to working with my colleagues to get it done. It's time to stop playing party politics with the public's health. I yield back.
Gentleman from Michigan.
Tom Emmer from Minnesota's 6th Congressional District. Many problems to Obamacare, the Affordable Care Act. Even Democrats have said that there's a lot of problems going on with it. And it's not just the website. The whole system is broken. I know one person whose daughter has the government-sponsored insurance but cannot use it because of the high deductibles. This even being debated here in Minnesota with MinSure. One of the problems, and this actually came from a Democrat, if I can find the quote from Tony Lurie. I cannot find the quote from Tony Lurie, the state senator, but I do have, the advantages that we're anticipating really didn't come to fruition. The entirety of that operation I'm going to read a paragraph out of the St. Paul Pioneer Press. The advantages that we were anticipating really didn't come to fruition, the Democrat from Carrick told us. Clear accountability to lawmakers under his proposal would bring the entirety of that operation in direct line with the authority mechanisms that are set up for our departments. The problem we're facing in Minnesota is the fact that most of the enrollees into the Obamacare system here, MinSure, are people who already qualify for either Medicare, Medicaid, or the other MinCare, the other low-income program. 85% of all enrollees are already able to be covered. That means only 15% of people who are in a free market-based system or not eligible for a low-income healthcare program here are part of this. And yet MinSure was created to be very flexible and respond to market conditions and changes with operating within a private market system, but that clearly is not happening. I know Senator Michelle Benson, a Republican from Ham Lake, believes that we ought to separate MinCare and the other types of low-income programs from the Affordable Care Act MinSure, and that's probably a good idea. The whole system is starting to wobble. We're already seeing this. Governor Dayton said it's going to wobble in 2017 or 2018, and it's already starting here in 2015. This thing was doomed to fail from the start. It was not well thought out. It was highly political. And that's really, really broken. And the thing that Tom Emmer brings out, Representative Emmer, makes a very valid point that we kind of really need to think about how to go forward. What kind of healthcare system do we want that's actually going to work? And let's not just say the system is bad just because it's currently bad, but what can we do, not necessarily just to fix it, but to start from scratch and do over and do something right. And that part I have to give Representative Emmer a lot of credit for. And now, speaking of our congressional delegation, Congresswoman McCollum, Betty McCollum, who represents the 4th Congressional District right here in St. Paul in the suburban area, along with counterpart across the river, Congressman Keith Ellison, they have both said that they are not going to attend Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu's address to Congress on March 3rd. He's going to adjust that joint session in the Congress, but the whole thing comes from the fact that Speaker of the House, John Boehner, is the one who invited Benjamin Netanyahu to speak in front of Congress. Hey, it's the Speaker's authority. He's well within his purview to do that. But here is the statement from Congresswoman McCollum. This is from her congressional website. As a member of Congress, the national security interests of the United States are my highest priority. So, I find it very disturbing when a foreign leader in the midst of a campaign for re-election is allowed to address Congress for the sole purpose of undermining a foreign policy priority shared by the Obama administration and our European allies to score political points at home. In my view, Mr. Netanyahu's speech before Congress is nothing more than a campaign event hosted by Speaker Boehner and paid for by the American people. Mr. Netanyahu's re-election campaign is not my concern, but politicizing and damaging the U.S.-Israeli relationship by aligning his government with Republicans in Congress against President Obama is something I completely reject. For these reasons, I will not be attending his address to a joint session of Congress next month. This is where I think the Congresswoman has gotten it wrong. She's gotten it wrong in the fact that President Obama has dispatched high-level campaign operatives from his own administration and his own party, which is the same party that she shares, to undermine Benjamin Netanyahu in Israel during this election. So she's sitting here saying that, oh, well, we can't put up with Netanyahu being here on a campaign stunt, all the while the very people and the very president that she supports is trying to undermine Netanyahu in his own country. And where was the opposition when President Obama had visited Governor Christie in New Jersey for that photo op in the middle of Hurricane Sandy, just before, days before the 2012 re-election campaign? I think that was a pretty highly partisan campaign stunt, much in the line of what we have with Congresswoman McCollum's statement. I think if you are a Jew in Minnesota, you should be very vocal in your opposition to Congresswoman McCollum and Congressman Ellison. And here's the reason why. We in Minnesota have elected Jewish people, Jewish descendants in the past. We have had Senator Norm Coleman. We have had Senator Paul Wellstone. We have had Senator Rudy Boschwitz. Jewish Americans, great people, regardless of the party affiliation. And they have stood together for Israel, with Israel. Clearly, Congressman Ellison and Congresswoman McCollum do not stand with Israel, and that's evident from the actions that these two members of Congress have taken from our state, along with, the fact that they're going to politicize everything for President Obama. Congressman Nolan, up in the 8th Congressional District, has said that he is going to attend that particular session of Congress. So clearly, it's not just a Republican versus Democrat thing here. And this is where I have to praise Congressman Nolan for doing the right thing. And we have not had any word yet from either of our senators as far as whether or not they're going to attend or back out. Now, I believe this is a joint session, so I don't think it's just going to the U.S. House of Representatives. So I think I'd like to hear from Senator Klobuchar. Like to hear from Senator Franken. Are you going to attend? I sure hope you will. Well, that concludes our section on local politics, but last week our producer Dallas and I had a chance to stand in the frigid cold before dawn, or before dusk, whatever, dusk, dawn. I get those confused. Dawn, yeah. It was before the sun had risen. It felt like Groundhog Day and, standing out there waiting for, Phil to come out and see whether or not he's going to see a shadow. Well, we had to stand out and see whether or not they're going to fly balloons in Hudson, Wisconsin. And somebody is just calling me to tell me, hey, I see you on TV. And stupid me forgets to take my cell phone out of the pocket. But we won't worry about that now. Let's just go to our introduction video to show you what it was like last Saturday morning. And yes, they even had llamas out there. They did not have groundhogs that day. They had llamas. They had a lot of kids around, a lot of activities for, you know, kids, people of all ages. It was really a great experience to be out at Hudson's Hot Air Affair. I thought they really did a great job with the setup. And they even had a farmer's market. So we're going to go right back to that video and just show you the marketplace that they had inside one of the buildings at the school that they had. Yes, I did buy maple syrup. I thought that the stuff that they sold there was just absolutely fabulous tasting, and it was a very full flavor, and it was a great experience. And so I did actually make my purchase. That was legitimate U.S. Federal Reserve notes that I had passed over the table, and then I mailed it down to Mom for a Valentine's Day present. And so she ended up getting that, and I'm sure that right now, this morning, she's probably sat there with my stepfather enjoying a beautiful, delicious pancake breakfast with some fresh Wisconsin maple syrup. So that was a really good experience. It was really good to see a lot of people who were crammed into the building with a lot of different crafts available. And then after that, we went out and had pancake breakfast.
Thank you.
And the hot air affair. Actually, this would have been the 25th anniversary of the Hudson hot air affair. The inaugural flight was held in 1990. We only had about 18 balloons that were out, and the largest number that they actually had in any given year was 56. And I don't know what year that was, but that definitely would have been impressive if we would have seen 56 hot air balloons in the middle of February in Hudson, Wisconsin. And then due to bad weather, there was one year, it was probably last year, that they only had two. So there's two balloons that went up in bad weather, but then there was as many as 56. So we're going to show you right now, and I'm going to ask that my mic stay up during this segment. And we're going to show the balloon rays of the yellow balloon. We got two balloons. Now, the furthest state that a pilot has come from the west was Jim Borchardt, who came from California. I'm giving you some history behind the Hudson Hot Air Affair. This is coming right from their website, hudsonhotairaffair.com. The furthest distance a pilot has come from the east was actually from Pennsylvania. So this brings people from all over the country. There was a balloon one year from Wells Fargo. They brought a stagecoach-shaped balloon. And then there was another one that was patterned after Smokey the Bear in the U.S. Forest Service. The following uniquely shaped balloons have participated in the Hudson Hot Air Affair: Garfield, Chicken, Dinosaur, Stagecoach, Chicky Boom, Balloon Hilda, Chesty the Bulldog. I think any Marine out there would have to say ooh-rah after Chesty the Bulldog. Smokey Bear, Wally the Clownfish, Rubber Ducky, Burgess the Penguin, the United Van Lines truck, a Pepsi can, and Mr. Diddles the Bear. And they've had torchlight parades, they've had a 5K run, and I'm waiting for some instructions here from our producer. And then he says that they raise the balloons by filling all the air by gas-powered fans. So, and that was just another fascinating tidbit of just being up close and personal with some of the hot air balloons. Unfortunately, because of the upper atmosphere winds, we were unable to actually see a balloon raising. We saw them inflated, but we did not see them actually take to flight. So we're going to bring Luke Sesnick on. He was supposed to actually be here live in studio today, but he had a family conflict that came up with the time of the show. So he was unable to make it today, and so we're going to show his announcement of the canceled flight last Saturday morning.
Everybody wants to direct attention to that green balloon going up the mayor. That's going to tell Luke what's going on.
Okay, pilots. Pilots, come on over.
You want me to do another one?
Yeah.
I don't think it's a life or death situation. Went out that way. Now it's all over there. So.
Yeah, I was going to go on to the fuel available after the event.
Good morning, everyone. This is Luke Sesnick, the Balloonmeister for the Hudson Hot Air Affair. After a little deliberation and watching our pie ball go out, knowing the direction that we're going, and also looking at the wind forecast, we have made the decision to stay on the ground. Unfortunately, we won't be flying this morning, but there are some pilots that will be putting their balloons up this morning so you get a chance to get up close and personal with them. So thank you all for coming out. Pilots briefing at 2:15, and hopefully we'll be doing this again at 3 o'clock and getting off the ground. So thank you so much for being out here, and enjoy your morning.
And there we have it. That was the canceled flight for the Hudson Hot Air Affair. I do not know if there was actually three times that weekend that they were supposed to have launched balloons. The first one was, you know, Saturday morning, then they had one for Saturday afternoon, then they had one for Sunday morning. I do know that the Saturday morning and the Sunday mornings were canceled. I do not know if they got off the ground on Saturday afternoon. According to the Hudson Hot Air Affair website, the ideal conditions for launching a balloon are to have light winds less than 6 miles per hour with good visibility, sunshine, or if it's cloudy, with high cloud ceilings. The unfavorable conditions: too strong of a wind, something over 8 miles per hour, or no wind at all, or if there's poor visibility with low cloud ceilings, or if there's snow or rain. So there's a parameter in which the balloon meister and all other balloon crews operate from, and unfortunately on Saturday morning the parameters fell outside of those parameters, and they were unable to actually lift off. So now let's take a look at one last video here, and that is raising the balloon.
Thank you.
Well, a typical balloon, the system, the whole system that they operate from, usually has an envelope, gondola, fuel tanks, 40 gallons of fuel, and weighs about 600 pounds, and that's deflated while on the ground. In the air, the complete system, including the weight of the air inside the envelope, is about 2.5 tons. Each hot air balloon has an average of price of $35,000 to $45,000 just to purchase. There are a few balloon manufacturers, but I do notice that the most frequent balloon manufacturer that the that were out in Hudson were actually came out of a firm called Cameron Balloons out of Michigan, and they were established back in 1971. So they got a 43-year history of designing and manufacturing hot air balloons, which is quite amazing. So I think we're going to actually take a look at one last video clip, and this is of the Freedom Flight balloon. This was Luke Sesnik's balloon. This is actually the fifth incarnation since Freedom Flight was founded back in 1989 to raise awareness on the prisoner of war missing in action issue. This is back when I was right out of high school, when I was working with Minnesota Won't Forget, POWMIA Incorporated, as their co-chair of political action. And that's when we heard that there was this group out of St. Cloud that was going to do a POW hot air balloon. And even though Luke was unable to make it here today, we do want to just show you the entire Freedom Flight balloon and its inflation process.
We're not going to take off today, are you? No, it's not a good direction to fly.
Yeah,
you know, because
they're just scared to go to
Lake Elmo, which is only going to be 15 minutes from here. You want to get on the ground because it's just all housing from that point on. You know?
Yeah. And then, is your car warm right now? Thank you.
Okay, ladies, get you over here. Goes on that side. Goes out on that side. Pam and I are going to lift up the burners.
You can let go.
And what you're going to do is take the white bag off, and take the white bag off from this side. Then you're going to take the white bag, and it goes in the trailer. So get it out.
Yep.
Here we go.
No, they're not
filled. That's a tag working. There you go. All right, you're gonna take it. All right, good.
Why
not? There we go.
Wait, don't we want to put the bag over the burners? So what you're gonna do is you're take. Come here.
Remember how to do this?
You're gonna take the carabiner off.
All on each side.
Yep.
You know, carabiner is already loose. You don't have to tighten it. You know, I take carabiner off.
I did it.
You guys want me to show you?
Yeah.
Okay. So what you do is you go like that, and you take both the cables off. And go the other way, it'd be a lot easier. Okay, and then you're going to take the cables, and you're going to go one on side, each side of it. Okay, and then you're going to put the carabiner. You saw how I had my foot in there, and I used to do that.
Oh, I wish I was taller.
Okay,
now, you take the carabiner, and I'll line it for you.
Listen, you know you've got a long time to load yet.
Huh?
It's better to say I wish things were shorter than this.
You push it through. Okay, now you gotta tighten that up.
Yeah.
Tighten that thing up.
Anything?
Yep. Tighten it up.
Did it go the right
way? Righty tighty, lefty loosey.
I'll give it up
and
down.
See? You don't have to be tall to do this. Just gotta hold your mouth the right way. Did you see that? She had her tongue sticking out. Oh, yeah, there you go. Okay, put the zipper at the top.
You guys are right now.
Ready? Three, two, one.
Watch your head.
Look at that.
Wow.
Here
we go.
Keep going.
No. Good job, girl. Good job.
notice that the entire weight of that basket is hanging on four carabiner clips. And it's just interesting to note as you watch through all these various videos, the different techniques that are used in inflating balloons. Some will unroll everything first and then get all of the lines all stretched out and then they'll do the inflation. Others have come through and just unpacked and then inflated right away. And then others assembled the basket. You know, just it's amazing how many different techniques that are used by the different balloon crews out there. There is no one standard way of doing things, but there are certain standard safety procedures that each crew has to follow. And there is an annual certified balloon safety seminar that all balloon crews should be going through. The thing that I appreciated about Luke Sesnick from Freedom Flight was the fact that he was teaching the people as he was doing it. And according to the Freedom Flight website, they request 6 to 8 volunteers every time they come to a location and somebody requests them. Freedomflight.org is how you can find more information. And you can actually catch the Freedom Flight balloon next weekend at the Fun on the Frozen Flambeau up in Ladysmith, Wisconsin.
It's just a little tart, but it's got the right message.
Otherwise, you can wait till June with Taser Days, and we'll be back in Brooklyn Park, and they'll be back here in the metropolitan area.
Okay, get your cameras ready.
Neil, over here.
The warmer we keep it up top, the more it forces the wind to go around.
And Luke, he was quite the showman. He was really, you know, his candor was really appreciated. His instruction was really keen. It was really, really cool to have been part of this last weekend. Just looking at freedomflight.org, they were in Phoenix back in January 23rd. Then they had Hudson Hot Air Fair. So it was the second event of the 2015 balloon season. As I just mentioned, next weekend they'll be at Fun on the Frozen Flambeau up in Ladysmith. They have a fundraiser coming up in St. Cloud on March 28th. Then there's a POWMIA recognition event at the VA Medical Center in St. Cloud on April 4th. And then they'll be in Anthony, Kansas in May 8th through 10th for the Sunflower Balloon Fest. And then they'll be doing a bunch of stuff up here in Minnesota throughout most of the year. I see in July 18th through 20th, they'll be in Wellsville, New York. So they really go across the country with this balloon to show awareness on the POW/MIA issue. And they do a fabulous job. And again, my thanks out to Luke Sesnick and the Freedom Flight crew for a fabulous event. Well, with fabulous events, we have one more event coming up, and that is on Monday. Monday is President's Day, which I think I would unofficially make this the second official holiday of North Star Oasis, the first being Groundhog Day. But I'm not really going to get too wrapped up into the history of President's Day. I will mention here, just looking at the Encyclopedia Britannica, a couple of quick facts for you. The origin of President's Day came from the 1880s when the birthday of President George Washington, commander of the Continental Army and first president, was celebrated as a federal holiday. 1968, Congress passed the Uniform Monday Holiday Bill, which moved a number of federal holidays to Monday, and the change was designed to schedule certain holidays so that federal employees had a number of long weekends. It had been opposed by those who actually believe that the holiday should be commemorated on the dates that they actually commemorate. And during the debating the bill in Congress, it was proposed that Washington's birthday be renamed President's Day to honor the birthdays of both George Washington on February 22nd and Abraham Lincoln, February 12th. Although Lincoln's birthday had been celebrated in many states throughout the country, it was never an official federal holiday. Following the discussion, Congress rejected the name change, but after the bill went into effect in 1971, President's Day did become the commonly accepted name, in part due to the fact that retailers use that name to promote sales in the holiday's proximity to Lincoln's birthday. President's Day is usually marked by public ceremonies in Washington, D.C. and throughout the country. So I'm going to show you right now part of a video of the night parade from the President's own Marine Corps band. They are the oldest established band, musical group in the United States, authorized by President John Adams in 1798. And they still perform nightly, perform annually. They go on tours. The President's own United States Marine Corps band. Well, this is actually the silent drill troop. And what you are watching is at the 8th and I Marine Barracks, United States Marine Corps Silent Drill Team. Now, if you note the ranks on many of these Marines, with one stripe, Private First Class. These guys are this well drilled and they have not been in uniform all that long. Everything is done to precision. Folks, don't try this at home with your own hunting rifles. You have not been trained. And yes, if you get hit in the head with the butt of a rifle, concussions do hurt. So again, don't try this at home. So in the last few minutes we have, we'll watch one more segment here. 8th and I Marine Barracks, Washington, D.C., headquarters of the United States Marine Corps. This is the Marine Corps Silent Drill Team. There are different ways of seeing the Silent Drill Team and the United States Marine Corps Band in person, but you'll have to consult the Marine Corps website in order to know what their tour schedule is like or how to get access to their drill parades at Marine Corps Barracks, Washington, D.C.
Thank you.
Even though this video is from last summer, I just felt it appropriate on President's Day, with the President's own United States Marine Corps Band and the Silent Drill Team, that in an honor of recognition of President's Day, that we would show this video today for North Star Oasis. And so what we're going to do here in the last few seconds that we have of today's show is just keep the video running, and then we'll just call it a day and ask you to like us on Facebook, follow us on Twitter, watch our videos on YouTube, and then we'll just see you next week. I'm your host, Jeff Williams. Thanks for watching.